Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Soundcheck on Visual Radio Arts. My name is Sara Vian, and tonight in the studio I have the Invisible System, which comprises of Dan Harper. Welcome, Dan.
Hi.
And Dennis Wint. Welcome, Dennis.
Welcome.
Okay. Now, this all started in Mali, Dan, didn't it?
Started in Ethiopia.
Right.
Started in Ethiopia before Mali.
Uh-huh.
It just started. I was living out there for 3 years as an aid worker and built a studio. It kind of did start in Mali, because I lived in Mali before Ethiopia, and I was tinkering around with studio equipment, but I was living in a backpack in the Sahara Desert, so I didn't really have a lot of equipment with me. And I moved to Ethiopia when my daughter was born, and built a small studio at the back of my house and started jamming with Ethiopian musicians. So that's really where it started off.
Wow.
And I moved to Froome with that and met Dennis in Froome. And we ended up doing some work together as well. So it kind of came from Africa and then back here. Mm.
So what, did you go over there with a charity?
I worked for a British charity. I was an aid worker and went over with the International Service. Worked for an environmental charity, cause that's my degree and background and whatever, and ended up out there. And spent 5 years living there, met a Malian lady, ended up married, ended up with a kid. And then thought, I better get inverted commas a proper job for a bit, and ended up taking a management job in aid work and didn't like it at all.
Mm-hmm.
Worked for a while in a kind of more bureaucratic role, I guess, and ran away, came back here.
Yeah.
When I didn't think that was really making much of a difference. In fact, I think the music that we've created between all the projects that have come from it, in a way, did more than the aid work I was doing in Ethiopia, in some ways, to be honest.
Yeah. So how did you move from the aid work into music specifically? Did you just...
I've always been involved. I've been playing in bands since I taught myself the guitar when I was 18. And before I moved out to Africa, I lived in Brighton and bought, like a lot of people at the time, bought a sampler and a mixing desk and started learning the basics of studio. And I've always been obsessed with it. That's something I can't get rid of. So, to be honest, I made the decision when I was sitting in a meeting and the manager was going on about some really boring management theory, and I was just sitting there thinking, what has this got to do with saving people's lives and getting out on the ground? I like working out on the ground, making a difference. And I sat there for 2 hours and I sketched a drum kit and the mic placements ahead, over it, and just thought, that's it, I'm going to go back to England and concentrate on that. That was decision made there. Really.
Yeah, okay. Well, more of that later. I mean, Dennis, how did you guys meet?
I met him in Brighton. We played in Brighton with Rhythmites.
8 years ago, yeah.
And Rhythmites,
I met Dan in Brighton.
Yeah, that's true.
And then one day I was walking through and he called my name.
Mm-hmm.
And I went over to talk to him.
Oh, right, yeah.
Then after that, I went up to his house and I was talking from recording.
Mm-hmm.
He actually didn't come to my house on purpose, though. He was going for a walk and my daughter was playing outside. And I think you recognised her and heard some music coming out of the studio window.
Mm-hmm.
And I turned round from where I was working and he was standing behind me.
Yeah.
And I think we made the track Backyard literally Back, 5 minutes after Dennis came up the stairs.
Did you used to live in Tube Street?
Yeah.
Yeah. I used to live in Tube Street, tell him something.
Yeah, because I've seen you singing in Bristol, I think, in the big, you know, the Spiegel tent. I think.
Yeah.
What project was that?
No, it was Rhythmites.
Oh, that was the Rhythmites, right.
Rhythmites, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, because, I mean, I've been looking at your history, Dan, and, you know, the two albums, you've done quite a lot of work, haven't you? But the two albums that I was reading about, was it Punt and...
Punt was the first one.
Street Clan.
Street Clan's the one.
And unbelievable reviews from national papers, Uncut, Mojo, etc.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you think that took off? Was it... Because I also... Is it the intention behind it, that you really want to make a difference to this music, and you talk about international development using music sort of thing. Do you think that's what sort of, you know, gave it the edge and got the attention?
I don't know. All I can tell you is when I was in Ethiopia, suddenly people that I have grown up listening to started communicating with me. The first one, I think, was Captain Sensible from the Dad. And he heard something online and he just thought, I'd really like to play guitar on that. And I was like...
Yeah.
You can if you want, and he did. And just
so you knew him anyway, did you?
No, I never met him.
No,
he just listened to the music online.
Yeah,
and things just started happening. I don't know why. And when I came back, it was going to be released with the Ethiopique series, and that kind of I got messed around a bit. And I, I kind of think if you believe in something, and I did believe in the music, I believed it should be out there, and I believed it had something. So I put it out myself, and I was running blind. I didn't know what I was doing. I was posting CDs for review in, like, say, The Guardian, after it had been released, and apparently you meant to do it 2 months before, but then they were on the phone saying, we want to review it, and it just, I don't know, it just went.
Yeah.
I can't really tell you exactly what I think is a myriad of things, but...
So what, were you kind of working with the African people out there and recording their work and then mixing it up?
No, not at all.
No.
A lot of it was in my spare time, which I didn't have a lot of. I'd sit and relax by writing music, and then I invited Ethiopian people I was meeting in to at first sing on top, and they'd never improvised. In Ethiopia, it's like, you sing that there, and I'm the other way around. I don't do that. Mm. Like Dennis will tell you, there's no way. I say, Dennis, can you sing that there? I don't believe that. I think you're meant to bring someone's essence out in music.
Mm.
So I gave them the chance to improvise and to sing, and it was probably the first time they'd ever written their own music and their own song. And then people kept saying, oh, could I play saxophone on that? Could I play washint on that? And it just grew. It just grew from that, really.
So how does the international development sort of come into it? How do you sort of apply that to the music? I mean, how is it connected to the music, the international development?
Well, I think the fact that you're communicating with each other through music, even though you speak different languages. Some of the singers, a couple of them only spoke Amharic. I couldn't even talk to them in English. It was all very visual and audio-based. But you're working together to a common, not goal, I hate that word, but to a common art form.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's teaching you to be together and work together and to create something, which is what international development's about.
Building communities?
Kind of. I mean, if you look at England now, it's a very multicultural island, and it's through working in this kind of way that happens, breaking down barriers and moving forwards.
Brilliant. Yeah. So are you based in Froome now then? Are you still connected with
I still
Africa?
Go back to Africa when I can. We go and visit my wife's family, and I've had, I did have an arts grant award to help me go back and record again. So yeah,
I remember seeing that in the paper actually.
I go out whenever I can. Not often enough. I'd be out every month if I could, but I don't get to go as much
Are you able to connect with the African government and work with the government to help them?
I would if I could, but it's one thing in international development, art and music is at the bottom of the pile. It's always quite deservedly in some ways, education, health, but they don't talk about art and music. That's one of the reasons that I left and did this.
Mm.
You don't see artists brought over there. You don't see... And this is culture. It is their culture. If you don't have music, you don't have art, you haven't got a culture. So I've never understood why they don't help and work with it. I don't understand that. So.
Have you had a conversation with them, though? Or?
I've had a conversation with a few people, but you can't just rock up and have a conversation with, you know, the people that could make a difference, I guess. It's a longer-term ambition of mine to make something like that happen.
Yeah.
And in Mali, I did try to meet the Minister of Culture when I was out there, and I was so busy recording it didn't happen, but it could happen through my wife's family and stuff. It could, and it will at some point. But
brilliant. So what are you currently working on?
I just finished a double Malian fusion album, and you'll hear some tracks. The first set tonight will be from that. It'll be like a live dub mix with the Malian vocalists.
Mm-hmm.
Second set will be with Dennis. Mm-hmm. So it'll be like a double Malian album, triple actually, because there's an instrumental one. So that's what I've just finished. It's just been mastered, and I've got to get it out over the next couple of months.
Mm. So when you say Malian, you mean sort of the essence is kind of Malian music, is that?
Or? Kind of. I mean, I went to Mali and improvised with musicians there for about a month, and we just wrote on the fly. As same Dennis would tell you, he's with his other band, like the Rhythmites, it's very structured, verse, chorus, middle, eight. I work a bit like an African griot, and it's just jam. It's just jam. It's woof. And I went out
there. So much lyrics, didn't it?
Yeah. And I went out there and thought, maybe I should try and do it a different way. And the Malian griots, because they're traditional musicians, looked at me, they went, what?
Yeah.
They don't work that way. So.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm going to have to cut you short there, but do stay tuned. We're going to have the first set, and then I'm going to talk to these guys more about the amazing work that they're doing.